Excuse, would this be Lady Bellamy's house?
Oh, would it be, please? Oh, Mr. Hudson, gentleman wanting something.
Yes? Is this Lady Bellamy's house?
Mr. Richard and Lady Marjorie Bellamy reside here. What is your business, please?
Well, I'll be wanting a few private words with her ladyship, if you'd be so good as to inform
her. Is her ladyship expecting you?
No, she'll not be expecting me at all, no. Is she at home?
Have you an appointment?
I have not, no, but she'd be glad I came.
Oh, will she? And what is the nature of your business?
Well, my name is Michael Dooley, late of the Indian Army. Invalided out I was, a bad stomach.
Her ladyship has her own arrangements for contributing to army charities. Queen Alexandra's Home of Rest.
Well, just you tell her ladyship that I was right through the northwest frontier with a friend of hers.
Yes, well, we've heard that one before, Mr. Dooley. Oh, no. There is a notice in the area gate, if you can read it. It says, no circulars, no hawker. Get out! Get away with you! Rose! I thought I told you to keep the front door shut in the mornings.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Hudson. What was it? Beggar?
Oh, one of those unwashed Irish vagrants claiming to be an old soldier. Time they were cleared off the streets by law.
Good morning, Rose.
Good morning, my lady.
Good morning, Sarah. I do hope you're feeling a little better.
Oh, yes, much better, thank you, my lady.
Now, you mustn't try and do too much. Oh, aren't those lovely? Now, beautifully, you've arranged
them.
Thank
you, my lady. I was wondering, would you like me to put some carnations in the motor car?
Now, what a good idea. Yes, by all means do. And would you tell Watkins that I need the car punctually at 2:30?
Yes, my lady. Flowers in the motor car. Whatever next?
Well, it gives a welcome touch of summer.
Gives a welcome chance to visit Mr. Watkins, I wouldn't wonder.
Oh, Rose, you've got some very peculiar ideas at times.
You're going home to the Muse, you can do something for me.
Yes, of course.
Get the antimacassars from the back of the car. I want to send them to the laundry.
Yes, my lady.
Ah, they're lovely, Annie. You know, it's a long time since a woman brought me flowers. Then it was only my old auntie when I busted my leg. For my button, all are these?
No, for the car.
Ah, pity. Well, hang on, I'll get some water from the tap.
It's not bad, is it, eh?
They're quite homely, really. Especially with the flowers. No, I'll do it. We don't want to get water on the carpet, do we?
It's like a little room, isn't it, eh? All them flowers and everything. You could live quite comfy in here.
You never been in a Rolls Royce before, have you?
Not particularly.
Yeah, well, look, I tell you what, why don't I take you for a spin in here, eh? When I go and fill her up for petrol, maybe?
What's this for?
Well, that's the speaking tube for when you want to give orders to the driver, see? Well, hang on a minute. I'll show you how it works. Well, go on, say something.
Wilkins, you stupid fellow. I thought I told you to go straight to Gorringe's.
Oh, so you did, my lady. Sorry, my mistake.
Look out, you fool. You nearly knocked that horse over. Are you intoxicated, sir?
No, teetotal, my lady. Must be the springtime in me blood.
Don't be impertinent, sir, or I shall discharge you without a character.
Oh, no, please, my lady. I don't want to follow me dad down the mine.
Don't go down the mine, Dad. There's plenty of coal in the grate.
Isn't it lovely?
You'll think it over, will you, about going for a spin with me?
Might.
When's your day off, Sarah? I've heard that Amsterdam is very nice this time of the year.
You forget yourself, Mr. Watkins. I am no longer a domestic servant, while you are still a mere shover.
Oh, yeah. Well, what are you doing now, then?
Taking these to the wash. And before I forget to mention it, Lady Marjorie would like you with the car prompt to 2:30.
Yeah, Rose. You weren't long.
What do you think I would be?
Here, give us a hand.
Even you've got a funny way of putting things, that Thomas. It makes you laugh, doesn't he?
Highly comical.
Don't let him get his greasy fingers on them clean antimacassars.
Thought you liked him,
Thomas. He's very clever at getting on the right side of people, especially ladies, is Mr. Watkins. I know. More talk and compliments than that, but all the time he's got his eye on the next step. Looking ahead, like, over your shoulder. Oh, he'll flirt with you, so long as it's useful to him. And then, well, so you just watch out, Sarah. And don't keep moaning over there, wasting his time and yourn.
Might I step inside, sir, and admire your automobile?
Yes, if you like.
Thanks. And a fine-looking motor car.
Trouble is, it shows every scratch.
Still, you ought to be proud to own a machine the like of that.
It's not mine. It belongs to my employer.
Oh, I see. Now, he be a wealthy man.
Not especially.
Famous, is he?
Tory MP for Beckenham South. He is, all right.
Oh, that'll be Mr. Richard Bellamy.
How do you know that?
Oh, well, look, I have a cousin living in his constituency. Oh, a fine man, so they say.
Undersecretary for the Admiralty, he used to be, yeah.
Oh, that a fact. I was in the... Oh, sorry. I was in the army myself. Just got back from Kabul.
And where's that, when it's your own?
It's on the northwest frontier of India. There's always a war going on there.
Mixed up in that lot, were you?
Yeah, the Khyber Rifles. Private Michael Dooley. That's me. I was in the same unit as Captain Charles Hammond. Now, there was a man you could respect.
Well, I can't say I've ever heard of him.
A friend of your lady Bellamy's.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't bother. I mean, it's no pleasure for me to have the door slammed in me face. Hey, if there's one class of person I can't be dealing with, it's butlers.
Do I take it you've been to our front door? Number 165?
Yeah, I just wanted a word with her ladyship. So, you see, I have something that belongs to her.
And Mr. Hudson shut the door in your face, did he?
Oh, I was just thinking that her ladyship would like her property back, that's all.
What property?
Her letters.
Letters?
Mm. And other items, like an opera programme and a lace handkerchief. And a photograph of her ladyship. Mementos, you might say. They must have meant a lot to Captain Hammond. Kept them locked in a tin box he did, along with these decorations.
How come you were? You got hold of them then?
Hmm? Oh, I was his Batman, you see. Ah, like brothers we were, fighting side by side, with the Afridis coming at us through the Khyber Pass, yelling their heathen cries. I'm proud to say I polished off the one that got the captain.
Got him? You mean this Captain Hammond is, he's dead, is he?
A knife, straight through the liver. I know, he never suffered. I think her ladyship would like to know that.
Now, hang on a minute, when an officer dies, they send his stuff home, don't he? I mean, to his relatives, I mean.
Well, true, that is the usual practice,
well,
yes.
Well, how the hell do you come to get away?
I know, well, you see, like, I felt that I still had a duty towards the deceased.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Now, the captain often used to talk to him about his widowed sister living in Cheltenham. Oh, very fond of her he was. Very fond. And I was afraid that she got enough of a shock as it was, hearing about the captain's death, you know. Without discovering from the letters that he had been canoodling with a married woman. And her the wife of a Tory MP at that. Do you follow me?
Look, you know what you should have done with those letters, don't you? Burnt them. To ashes, the lot of them.
Well, it occurred to me that her ladyship might prefer to have them back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Women can be very sentimental about such things, you know.
Yeah, well, look, I tell you what, Mr. Dooley. You give me those letters, and I'll make sure she gets them back, all right?
No, I don't think that'd be very proper. No, I tell you what. You have a word with her ladyship, and tell her the circumstances, and arrange for her to receive me, huh? And if there's any question of a reward, I'll see you right. Now, I can't say fairer than that now, can I?
A reward? What sort of a reward were you thinking of?
£100.
£100. You all right in the top story, are you? No letters are worth £100.
These ones are. And they're for sale only.
Do you know what I think, Mr. Dooley? Oh. I think you made all this up.
Like what, oh?
All this about Captain Hammond.
Now you just stay where you are, Taffy, and I'll show you a sample of my wares. There. There's one. See? And I have a whole bundle tucked away.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, I'll find out what I can, and you come back later tonight, right?
All right, sir, all right, yeah.
Ah, good morning, miss. That's a grand day, thank God.
Yeah. Who's that?
Oh, he just popped in to have a look at the car, that's all. You thought any more about spending your day off with me, have you?
Might. If her ladyship can spare you.
Well, what's that supposed to mean?
Well, I wonder if she'd go out driving quite so often if her chauffeur was 65 years old with curly teeth. The rest of the staff think she's taken quite a shine to you.
Oh, her ladyship? Never.
Why else did she give that rise last month?
Well, for my outstanding presentability and all-round skill.
That's roughly what I thought. Do you know it reminds me a bit of Ada Liversidge?
Ada Liversidge? Mm.
She's on the bill with me at the Oxton Empire.
Oh, yeah.
Monologues and refined juggling. Lovely act. Proper Lady Mac she was, but it wouldn't melt. Well, one night we come in early and we found her in the paint room with the theatre fireman. It's a uniform, you see, all them buttons. So you better watch out, my boy.
Yeah, well, you don't have to worry, Sarah.
You do what you like. It's no skin off my nose.
I can't see a lady of quality losing her head over one of her own servants.
Oh, they do sometimes, so I've heard tell. Quite grand ladies.
Have you ever heard tell of Lady Marjorie going off the rails?
How should I know?
Oh, it's just that I thought you knew most of what went on in this house, that's all.
What you being so hopeful all of a sudden for, eh?
Oh, it's just an excuse to come and talk to you, really, Rose. It seems goodness knows how long since we had a chat.
Not much to chat about anymore. You've got your life, I've got mine.
Rose.
Well, it's true. I don't know where I am with you no more.
Sometimes I think I was better off in the old days when you and me used to share that room together. Do you remember we used to lie awake at night and talk about all the things he's going to do?
Yeah, well, you did one or two of them, didn't you?
Yes. Oh, well, it is better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all.
What's that supposed to mean? I don't see you got that much out of all that.
Memories, Rose. Memories.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I wasn't cut out for the humdrum bonds of marriage. You see me washing some fella's socks and wiping his children's runny noses?
No, I can't, not now you mention it. But just because you don't fancy it, don't mean to say it's not a good idea.
Oh, you'd like it, wouldn't you?
Yes, I would. Only I don't seem to get no offers.
Kiss your hand.
What for?
Come on, I might be able to see. Well, you've got nothing to worry about, have you? See, it's all there, clear as daylight. See all them little lines?
Yeah, what are they?
Children, Rose. Mm-hmm. Yes, one a year till 1920.
Uh-oh, poo.
If the first one's a girl, will you call her Sarah after me?
Of course I will. You can be godmother if you allow it.
I would. About the nearest I'll ever get to having one of my own.
Don't say that. I'm sure you'll find somebody.
Thought I had.
Captain James? Oh, Sarah, you didn't really think...
I did, Rose. Really. Oh, I know he's a bit of a philanderer, but I thought he'd settle down like his father. Now, that's what I call an ideal marriage. Years of wedded bliss, them two upstairs, and but in all that time, she's never looked at another fella.
What makes you so sure?
Well, she's not the type, is she?
Looks can lie sometimes.
What do you mean, Rose?
Well, between you, me and the gateposts, Lady Marjorie's had her little moments. Only it's not to go beyond these four walls.
Little moments, Lady Marjorie? Do you mean another gentleman?
It must have been when you was away. You could almost say she cast her bonnet over a windmill.
Well, with Rose? Walker, what? Tell me.
me?
You swear you won't breathe a word to a living soul?
I cross my heart. Now tell.
Well, he was in the army, same as Captain James. Couple of years older, maybe. Blue eyes, ever so romantic looking. Younger than her ladyship, of course. Well, Captain James brought him to the house one evening. Her ladyship took one look at him, and she was done for.
It sounds like one of them magazine stories that Mrs. Bridges says was only fit for scullery maids.
Well, be that as it may, Miss Roberts always said they fell in love at the opera.
Soft music, dimming lights. Mm. Did the master know?
Of course not, silly. But we all did below stairs. See, this Captain Hammond, he was on leave from India, and he'd taken rooms in Ebury Street. She used to go there in the afternoon. Mrs. Bridges saw her. She saw her coming out, all felled and mysterious looking, so we knew something was up. He used to send her flowers every day with bits of poetry attached, and she used to write him billy-doos.
How do you know?
Well, the blotter in her boudoir. We used to hold it up against the mirror. You could see the writing ever so clearly.
How long ago was all this?
About 3 years.
And how did it end then?
Well, this Captain Hammer went back to India and got killed in action. Mm. Mr. Radson read about it in the paper. Rose said they was all dreadfully upset downstairs when he read it out. And she said Lady Margie went around looking all pale and sad. So that was that. Nothing to show for a romance but few fading memories. All gone, all forgotten.
Not a lock of hair, a photograph, or even a packet of love letters.
That's what Rose said. Mm.
Shame, isn't it?
Why are we stopping here?
I beg your pardon, my lady, but I've got something most important to say to you.
Surely it can wait. I told you I must get to the jeweller's, otherwise... What on earth do you think you're doing?
I'm sorry, my lady, but there's no other way of speaking to you in private. You see, there's an individual, Irish, I think, trying to wheedle some money out of you.
What a tradesman of some kind?
No, my lady, an old soldier, that's what he says. He saw service in India.
I'm sure you had a most interesting conversation, but I didn't want to hear about it. Now, will you please take me to the jeweller's as I asked you?
M'lady, this man has in his possession some letters.
Letters?
Written by your good self, I understand. They are signed, so the man claims, by your ladyship, and coming from Eaton Place.
And whom does he say they're written, these letters?
To someone by the name of Captain Hammond.
I hardly think that my correspondence with Captain Hammond would be of interest to anyone. He was merely an acquaintance of my son's who came to the house on various occasions.
Oh, yes. Yes, I see, my lady.
I seem to remember reading that he was killed on active service.
Yeah, that's right, my lady. This man Dooley was with him when he died.
Dooley? A brother officer of Captain Hammond's?
No, he was the captain's batman, my lady.
See.
That's how he'd come to be in possession of the letters, he.
And you say this batman is asking for money in exchange for the letters?
Yes, my lady. I thought I ought to make the position clear. I hope you don't mind me mentioning, my lady.
No, you did quite right, Watkins. Tell me, did any of the other servants see this man?
No, my lady. Mr. Hudson shut the door in his face without asking what he wanted, and he came around to the mews to try and make himself agreeable to me.
Yes, I see. Watkins, I think it might be as well if you didn't mention him to anyone.
Very good, my dear.
I suppose it's simply that he expects some sort of reward in return for lost property.
That's right, my lady. £200.
£200? That's a great deal of money.
Yes, that's what I told him, my lady.
When will you be seeing him again?
Well, he's coming back later this evening. Would you like to speak to him yourself, my lady?
No, I don't think that would be necessary, as you seem to involved yourself in all this.
Well, there's no choice of mine, lady.
The question is how to raise such a large sum of money in so short a time.
Shall I drive you to the bank, my lady?
No, I don't want to go to my bank. Watkins, are there not establishments where it's possible to raise a loan on the security of some possession? You can leave that here, Watkins. I'll get Hudson to have it sent up later.
Very good, my lady.
Oh, and I shall need the car again today, thank you.
Very good, my lady.
There you are, my dear.
Psst. What?
She was pretty shaken, I can tell you. Turned quite pale, she did.
Yeah, I told you it was true. Rose wouldn't make up a thing like that, poor woman.
She had to pop a necklace so the master wouldn't find out. I got the money.
How much?
Do you mind?
Tea's ready. Below stairs.
I have to put the car away. Well, hang on a minute. Give us a kiss.
Not in here. Later.
Thank you, Rose.
Madre? You look worried, Madre. Oh,
sorry.
Anything the matter?
No, not really. I was just thinking about various things. James? Well, wondering whether his regiment might be in action one day. I worry about him.
Things are quiet on the northwest frontier at the moment.
That's good.
There's been no trouble out there since the fighting with the Freedies last year, when they had a number of casualties in the Khyber Rifles.
Well, that's all right, then.
Who is it?
It's me, Dooley.
Well, come upstairs, it's more private. Oh, mind your head.
No, thanks. Word with her ladyship, have you?
Yes, I have.
That was quite a shock for her, the poor soul, discovering that her little indiscretion had come to light. Thought she got away with it, huh?
No, I don't think she thought that.
What do you mean?
Well, it wasn't such a dark and guilty secret as you imagined, see?
Well, it ought to be. A married woman carrying on like that in her and high society.
Aye, well, I don't think they pay a great deal of attention to that sort of thing in high society. I mean, not nowadays.
Well, they damn well ought to. Are you telling me that her misbehavior was common knowledge?
Oh, no, but I think she made a clean breast of it, so I hear.
To her husband?
Your letters won't tell him anything he doesn't know already.
Huh?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mr. Dooley, you seem to have been under a misapprehension.
What do you mean?
Yeah, those letters are a lot of useless rubbish, man.
Oh, I wouldn't be too sure about that.
Now, listen, she did say she'd give you fiver for them. Yeah, she'd like the photograph, see? Now, that's only in the way of charity, no?
Upper crust, indeed. I wouldn't give you a tuppence for the lot of them.
I will. Never mind the tuppence, Mr. Dooley. Do you want a fiver or not?
Fiver? Come to think of it, maybe there is such a thing as a public duty.
public duty.
Hmm. Maybe the public has a right to know the way the betters behave themselves in the privacy of their wealthy homes.
Well, I don't think it's any of their business, Mr. Dooley. I mean, not the ordinary common head.
And who elected Mr. Richard Bellamy into Parliament? Will you tell me that? The ordinary, honest working man. That's who put him up there in Westminster.
Yeah, well, I think they're mostly bank clerks in Beckenham, Mr. Dooley.
Yeah, well, maybe they are. But are they going to vote for a man who upholds immorality? Oh, no, me lad. I'll soon put a stop to that. You'll see.
No, I don't see you, Mr. Dooley. Now, what are you going to do about it? Stand on street corners giving the letters to anyone passing by, is it?
Not at all, no. There are those who put these facts into print for all to see. Lord Northcliffe, to name but one. Now, there's a man with a strong sense of public duty. And it's just the stuff for the Daily Mail.
You think so, do you?
I do. And I'll tell you something else. I'll get myself a tidy sum for them letters when I offer them to a newspaper.
A newspaper? Oh, well, that's different, isn't it?
It is, Taffy, isn't it? It's different now.
Yeah, well, look, I tell you what, I'll lie. I'll give you the £100 on behalf of her ladyship.
Well, you lying Welsh bastard! Oh, yeah. Well, I'm sure we can do better than £100 now, Taffy. 200.
She'll never pay £200.
And then you'll only have to go to your master, won't you? After all, he is a Member of Parliament. He won't want this sort of stuff to be going into the newspapers now, will he? £200, Taffy. That's my price.
You did quite right to inform me, Mr. Watkins.
Well, I felt it was my duty, Mr. Edson.
Those letters are undoubtedly forgeries. I could tell that the man who came round to your mews after I'd shown him the door was nothing more than a common impostor. Someone who'd obviously taken the trouble to look up the family in Debrett's peerage.
Oh, yes, yes, I see, Mr. Edson.
And to make up some cock and bull story about her ladyship and some army officer called, whatever it was.
Captain Hammond.
Quite. London is full of such people, Mr. Watkins. Confidence tricksters, no less.
Well, I'm only pleased that there's no truth in what this man Dooley says, Mr. Edson.
You can put the matter right out of your head, Thomas.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Edson.
Now get on with your work. Mr. Watkins.
But Hudson, you've been in this house long enough to know that there's nothing involving her ladyship that even Lord Northcliffe could turn into a scandal.
Oh, nothing at all, sir. I just felt that you'd wish to be informed about this man's absurd claim.
That's right. He's probably got heard of letters written by her ladyship to some relative.
Quite so, sir.
Affectionate, but entirely innocent.
I'm sure you're right, sir. On the other hand, sir, one gathers that the wording of the letters renders them open to some misrepresentation.
I'm sure it does. The most harmless correspondence can be twisted in some way. People are always ready to believe the worst.
Well, that's very true, sir.
Do you know to whom my wife is supposed to have addressed these letters?
I don't think there's anything to be gained by repeating slander, sir.
No, I see that. All the same, presumably the innuendo is that her ladyship has had an illicit liaison of some kind. I can't give the light to it unless I know who the fellow's meant to be. You do see my point?
No, quite, sir.
Where's Watkins now?
I've asked him to wait outside in the hall, sir.
Send him in.
Very good, sir. Mr. Watkins.
Oh, come in, Watkins. Hudson tells me a man has approached you in the mews with some proposition or other.
Yes, sir. I hope you don't think I did wrong to mention it, sir.
Oh, no, you were absolutely right. I'm glad to see you have the same spirit of responsibility as the other servants in this house. All right, Hudson.
I beg your pardon, sir. I feel I ought to remain since Mr. Watkins...
I take your point, Hudson, but I don't need you. That'll be all.
Very good, sir.
In the ordinary way, I'd have no compunction in handing this man over to the police. But since my wife's honour is being challenged, I intend to proceed more delicately. You understand what I mean, don't you?
Yes, sir.
I do not intend to allow my wife to be in any way upset.
No. Oh, no, sir.
You haven't, of course, said anything to her about this man.
Well, how could you think I'd do a thing like that, sir?
Quite. Well, since you've shown such excellent discretion so far, may I rely on your discretion a little further?
Naturally, sir.
When you see this man again, I want you to find out exactly what he wants.
Well, I've already done that, sir. Did Mr. Hudson not tell you?
He merely informed me that a man claiming to possess certain letters signed by her ladyship had called round at the garage. Hudson is under the impression the man is a harmless imposter. Quite frankly, I'd rather leave Hudson with that impression.
Quite, sir.
How much is this man asking for the letters?
£200.
Oh.
That's a great deal of money, sir.
Well, if it's a question of keeping her ladyship in ignorance of such a distasteful affair, I'd gladly pay 10 times as much.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that, sir.
Now, if I do negotiate with this man, will he keep his side of the bargain?
You leave that to me, sir. I'll make sure that he does.
Very well, Watkins. I hereby instruct you to buy back those letters, whatever they may contain, without her ladyship's knowledge. As man to man, can I trust you?
You can, sir.
Thank you, Watkins.
Is it all right if we come in? Have you spoken to his nibs?
No, I haven't.
The price is 200 now, Taffy, and don't you forget it.
The price has been agreed.
Oh, I thought so.
The ladyship has decided to pay all of it.
After all, what's a couple of hundred quid to such a wealthy woman?
Well, a drop in the ocean, innit?
Well, come on, let's see the colour of your money.
Hold on just a minute, Mr. Dooley. Now, you wouldn't expect my mistress, a lady of quality, to trust me with £200 in banknotes, would you? I mean, me, a chauffeur? A simple servant?
No. I wouldn't trust you with a baby's rattle myself.
Her ladyship wishes to receive the letters from you personally.
Oh, does she indeed?
She also would like to hand over the money to you herself. I am merely the go-between.
Look, I'll not wait much longer now. I'm warning you.
You won't have to, Mr. Dooley. The transaction can take place tonight.
Where?
Well, there'll have to be a secret meeting place, won't there?
In the park, maybe.
Now, you wouldn't expect my mistress to wait under a tree in Hyde Park, would you?
No.
I mean, somebody might come by and recognise her, isn't he?
So I'll come to her room, will I?
You come to the garage here tonight at 11 o'clock. Now, I'll leave that small door open for you.
And then what?
Well, I'll be driving a ladyship home tonight about 11:30 or thereabouts. Now, with her permission, I'll drive straight into the garage. And if I close those big doors, you can conduct your business in the back of the car. And nobody will disturb you, see?
You know, Taffy, I like that idea. I like it very much. In the back of the Rolls. Tonight, me and Lady Marjorie. Huh? I'll be here, Taffy. I'll be here.
right.
In the back of the car, please, Mr. Dooley. Private Michael Dooley, m'lady.
May I wish you the compliments of the season, me lady.
In the car, please.
It's very kind of your ladyship to receive me personally in your motor car.
There was little alternative, since I am not accustomed to receiving common soldiers in my drawing room.
Well, I may be a common soldier, me lady, but I have to earn a living. Times are very hard, you know. I have enough good boys here. 7 years serving His Majesty and not even a gratuity.
So you resort to blackmail?
Now, there's no need to be insulting. A woman in your position shouldn't behave like that. It's not right. Don't you want common people to respect you?
Not particularly, Mr. Dooley.
Oh, yeah, well, I can't sit here all night arguing. Now, you've got to pay up, or aren't you?
First, I must be sure if you are whom you pretend to be. Show me your discharge papers.
Oh, I don't carry them around with me.
Then you're not like any old soldier I ever heard of. Wilkins? Can we trust this fellow?
Well, that's up to you, my lady.
How do I know that you're a friend of Captain Hammond's?
I was his Batman, wasn't I?
Were you? I don't know.
Well, I can prove it. He had a mole on his left cheek. Now, you'd remember that.
Ah, yes. Poor Charles and his mole. I remember once
I... beg your pardon, my lady, but I think we ought to be getting on with the transaction now.
Not until I've told Mr. Dooley exactly what I think of him. Are you not ashamed to batten upon the frailty of a woman, you scoundrel?
Who are you talking to?
Stinking blackguard.
The transaction, my lady.
Yes. Yes, yes, quite right, Wilkins. Let us conduct this affair in a civilized fashion. I apologize. Offer Mr. Dooley some refreshment.
Very good, my lady. Come here, man. Now you can drink to Ladyship's health and the conclusion of our successful negotiation.
No, I'll do that. Thanks.
Now you may give me my letters, may you not, Mr. Dooley?
Oh, my pleasure, my lady. There. Can you remember them?
Ah, yes, immediately. The sight of them upsets me.
Now, I'll take the money first, my lady, if you please.
Wilkins, give Mr. Dooley his money and let us end this painful ceremony.
Very good, my lady. Mr. Dooley.
Five, 10, 15, 20.
Lord, you are counting.
I think you have. What have you got in that bag?
Only a brick.
It's all right, he's breathing steady.
Look, it's them letters.
You take good care of them now. Come on to him then, will you? There we are, my old son.
That's right,
my old son. Now then. Look, we'll go and see if the coast is clear. Up we get, son. That's it. Now then. Listen, we're going to put you where you belong, ain't you? In the gutter, innit? Shh. That's me, old soldier. Come on, then. Listen, we've lost your hat. There you are, man. Now then. Go and wait into my room and be quiet till I get back. Shh. There you are. Now then. Well, we bumped into a policeman at the corner of Elizabeth Street. I told him I'd pick Dooley out of the gutter.
and he's taken him in charge as drunk and disorderly.
Do you know what? You're very clever, Mr. Watkins.
Watkins, my lady.
That's all settled with him.
That's right. All settled.
There's more than 100 quid in there.
I know, there's 400 quid in there.
Well, where'd you get the rest from?
200 from her. And 200 from him.
Who?
The master.
What for?
For his share of the letters.
Yes, but I thought Lady Marjorie popped her necklace for £100 so that she could buy the letters back.
She'll get them back, some of them.
Some of them? Well, what about him?
He'll get the rest for his share of the money, won't he?
Oh, I see. And Mr. Thomas Watkins makes himself a nice, fat, juicy 200 from each of them for half the letters.
Well, a man's entitled to a fee for handling such delicate negotiations.
Not the bloody lot.
A commission, you might say.
Now, look. I come here tonight because I thought you was going to help Lady Marjorie, not diddle her. This family's been very good to me and I'm not going to let them think I was involved in this. You give the money back or I'll tell them.
What did you say?
You heard. Now, look. Do you think Dooley's going to let you get away with this?
And why wouldn't he?
Well, he's not going to be very pleased when he wakes up in jail and works out what you've done to him.
I thought of that. He won't say anything to the police. He's a blackmailer himself, isn't he?
Don't you think he's going to find a way of letting Lady Marjorie know you was in on this? Come on. Where are you going to be then, eh? Sunk. No job, jail and all for £400. If you're going to do them for something big.
Give me those letters.
Well?
I'll clear off. I got some thinking to do.
Watkins wishes to speak to you, sir.
Oh, does he? Come in, Watkins. What is it? Thank you, Hudson.
Very good, sir.
Well?
I've carried out your instructions, sir.
Have you got those letters?
I have, sir. And we won't be hearing from Mr. Dooley again, I think. There you are, sir. All 7 of them.
Thank you. Hand me those matches, please, Watkins.
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you. What have you got there?
200 Jimmy O'Goblin, sir. What do you give me?
Well, how on earth...
Well, I didn't like to see a man like that profit from his villainy, sir, so I took it upon myself to play a trick on him. Under the circumstances, I thought it was quite justified, sir. It was very successful.
Well, I won't ask you how you managed it, Watkins, but let me say at once I am very much in your debt.
Well, thank you very much, sir. Will that be all, sir?
No, Watkins, there's one more thing. I'd like to show you how much I appreciate your honesty. Some servants... in your position, being entrusted with £200, would have made up some cock and bull story and pocketed the lot.
Oh, well, we don't go in for that sort of thing in the Valley, sir. I mean, I was brought up very strict. My father was an elder of the chapel, see?
That's quite. So I am giving you £10 to spend in any way you choose. Well, of course, if you would like to invest it, don't hesitate to ask me for advice.
Oh, well, thank you very much, sir. I am most grateful.
Whatever you do, don't say anything about this to her ladyship.
So there you are, my lady. There's your £200 back.
Thank you, Watkins. I am very grateful to you. And I'd like to give you a little reward for your trouble. I believe the usual thing for the return of stolen property is 10%, so will you please accept £20?
Oh, no. No, I couldn't, my lady.
Yes, of course you could, Watkins.
Well, thank you very much, my lady.
And you'll keep those letters safe and sound, won't you?
Yes, I will.
Where to now, my lady?
Well, I suppose we'd better go back to that odious pawn shop and retrieve my necklace. And then home.
Very good, my lady.
So it's all cleared up, is it? The matter of the Irishman and the letters.
Oh, that matter, yes, I think so, Mr. Hudson. Well, he hasn't been back to the mews again.
In other words, the whole affair was indeed a shocking attempt to extort money from her ladyship for some non-existent letters, as I forecast.
Yes, that's right, Mr. Hudson.
And the master endorsed my instructing you to ignore the matter unless the man came back.
Yes, quite.
Then the matter is closed, Mr. Watkins, and need not, indeed should not, be mentioned again.
Very good, Mr. Hudson.
You better go and put the car away, Mr. Watkins.
What are you doing here, then?
Have you done it?
I've given the letters and all the money back to the people concerned, yes?
All the money? What, and not kept nothing for yourself, not even a few bob? Well, that's not fair, considering all the work you've done.
Well, I have made something.
How much?
I didn't ask for it. They both gave me a bit. Not much. Here you are. Here's your half.
£3? Oh, thanks, Tom. I suppose they both trusted you and you didn't let them down.
Did you honestly think I would? You did, didn't you?
I like to think I made an honest man out of you, Mr. Wilkins.
Watkins, my lady.
Give us a kiss.
Well, help yourself.
Ah, there you are.
You shouldn't have waited for tea. I've been shopping.
So have I. And I got a small gift. Nothing really, just a little ornament.
Richard, how sweet of you. And how strange.
Strange?
Well, I bought something for you, too. It's only a cigar cutter to replace the one you lost.
Oh, my dear, how thoughtful of you. Thank you.
Some money I thought I'd spent wasn't spent after all, so I decided to buy my husband something with it.
And I, too, made a wise investment, so...
Oh, Richard, that's lovely. Oh, it's beautiful. I shall keep it on my dressing table.
Now, how about some tea?
Yes, I hadn't realized how late it was. I'm afraid I'd get Watkins from his tea.
He won't mind. He's a good fellow. I've changed my opinion of him lately.
I'm glad.
You're quite right. He's a good chauffeur. He's smooth and reliable.
He's very trustworthy.
Yes.
Do you think we might increase his wages a little?
I've already done so.